afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to see you speech room so full after 2 years of necessarily fast attendance. When preparing this speech, I was tempted to postpone any mention of co-education until the last 5 minutes, the last minute of my 5 minute slot, just in case some enterprising thick woman was running a sweepstake on how early I would mention it. Clearly, I've decided to take a different course. I realised I was deluding myself about the level of interest my speech would excite. You can't make a book that's a non-existent market. More fundamentally, it would fail to do justice to the importance and significance of the movement. As governors, we fought long and hard before making the decision. In the 147th year of the John Lowndes School and the 450th year of the John Lowndes Foundation, no one can accuse us of rushing into it. We were confident of our future as an all-boys school, and if something is working well, it's tempting not to risk any change. However, we thought it was the right thing to do, both for our existing pupils and for our future pupils. We wanted to broaden the opportunities and experiences for both categories of pupils by widening access to our educational values and facilities. By starting co-education in Year 7, we wanted to keep faith with those parents who had chosen an all-boys school for their children, whilst demonstrating our commitment to converting JLS over time into an all-through co-educational school, in which every pupil is valued and able to flourish. I realise it is still early days, and there may well be issues in the years to come. But as governors, we are delighted with the outcome of the school's first year of co-education. And on behalf of the governing board, I'd like to say a big thank you to all the parents who put their trust in us, and to their daughters who have shown the talents and the courage to rise to the challenge in such a conspicuously successful way. I would also like to pay tribute to the head, the senior leadership team, and all the staff at school who have done so much to make this movement a success. Last but not least, here's my captain Paul, who did not take the attitude of their school, but made all feel welcome by treating it as everyone's school. This year has also seen the incorporation of Prenton Hall Prep School into a single school with John Lyon. Prenton Hall already had many of the academic and classical cultural care values we seek to promote at John Lyon. And we are confident it will be possible under the leadership of Catherine Haynes and Simon Ford to combine the best of both traditions to create an outstanding 3-18 co-educational school. By doing so, we aim to make available benefits of our history, our educational standards and our facilities to a wider group of pupils. At this stage, I thought of attempting some elegant segue into a review of political and economic events and how they may impact on school life. I quickly realised that this task was far beyond my powers of socio-economic analysis, something best left for my fellow governor, Mr. Leo Callaghan of GB News. After the choppy waters of Brexit and COVID, I suspect I was not alone in looking forward to a period of plain sailing. However, we are now facing an unstable geopolitical environment, domestic rates of inflation not seen since the 1970s. Of course, I should have realised the world does not stop throwing up challenges, and the need to adapt is inevitable as well as beneficial. Better communications and social media bring the news of each crisis, no matter how far away it occurs, not merely into our living room, but right in front of our eyes through our iPhones. The scale of problems can sometimes induce a sense of powerlessness. But we should always remember, particularly in this room, Winston Churchill in 1941, it is never, never, never giving a speech. So much can be achieved by individuals responding positively and cooperatively to the particular problems in front of them. In its unstated but significant way, the school attempts to prepare its pupils for challenges ahead. The critical skills to think for themselves and to question outdated assumptions. The self-reliance and the fellowship that individual or team performances engenders, along with the confidence and self-reflection that triumphs and disappointments properly evasion. These all help in equipping our pupils to make the right individual and collective decisions to overcome future difficulties. So life will not remain the same, and the ride may sometimes be complex, but there are so many opportunities to make a positive difference, as well as having some fun. So I look forward to seeing all our pupils carrying on being committed and optimistic and enjoying the ride. Thank you for listening.
Examination. I wish you good luck in achieving the excellent results that you thoroughly deserve. To all our upper six leaders, I wish you good fortune in your transition to the next stage of your lives, to university and beyond. And I shall give a special mention to this year's head boy, Vinay Kapoor, and his excellent team of sixth form prefects. Student leaders they are. Tonight we say grateful thanks to all of our John Ryan staff and the dedication and commitment of our teaching staff. John Ryan teachers bring excellence to their subjects. They treat our students as individuals, setting high targets and helping them to achieve the very best. We say farewell and thank you to the members of staff and some retiring governors who are leading us. We wish them well and good luck in the future. Our school is far more than a collection of buildings and facilities, impressive as they are. The John Ryan School is about people. Current pupils, former pupils, our staff and our parents. Together with Quainton Hall, now as a larger combined school of prep and senior, we have celebrated John Ryan's 145th year recently and Quainton Hall's 125th year now. And with the introduction of co-education, this year has marked a true milestone for John Ryan. I'm certain that our school will continue to go from strength to strength. Under the Governor's excellent guidance, for which I'm enormously grateful, the school is driving forwards to further successes. These are exciting times for John Ryan. Maybe we already knew and took for granted the value of being part of the John Ryan family. But with normality here at last after a long pandemic, I am so pleased and I am so proud as a school that we have bounced back after those challenging and unpredictable times. Our values have shone through. I invite you all to judge the school by our successes, by our actions and our outcomes. The joy that you are part of the John Ryan School, present and past and future. Our aspirations are high, because our pupils, your sons and your daughters, deserve the best. University of Twickenham here in London. Azaleen has proudly served the school both as a governor and deputy chairman and as a foundation governor. His commitment to education is strong and unique, having held the role of chief executive of the UCAS University Application System and of the QAA body which regulates higher education across the UK. More recently, he has returned from working in Australia in a leading role with their national regulator. He is passionate about educational provision for young people through universities, colleges, and specialised institutions. We are very privileged indeed to have Anthony McCarron with us here this evening. Welcome home, sir. I should now like to ask Anthony to address the school and to present the prizes.
Chairman of Governors, members of the governing body, head and staff of the school, ladies and gentlemen, Ionians, it's a particular honour as an old Ionian to be asked to speak to you this evening and to present prizes to those who've achieved so much over this academic year. But if I appear to be gripping this lectern rather more tightly than usual, the explanation is simple. Being here in speech room takes me back immediately in imagination to my own school days at John Lyons. They were, in many ways, different times. I have a vivid memory of a giant, literally, of the chemistry labs, Mr. Vernon, nunky to generations of Ionians, an imposing chemistry master, and a dead shot with a piece of chalk from across the laboratory. We learnt the ability to duck far faster than we learnt the periodic table. Parents, be reassured, we now, of course, live in far more enlightened times. As an old Ionian, I was here at John Lyon from 1969 to 1976, which sounds like a very long time ago, even to me. Whiteboards were blackboards, the chalk face was not metaphorical, but literal, particularly if, as I say, you failed the ducks swiftly enough. As an old Ionian, I feel an enormous sense of pride to be standing here with the opportunity to speak to this generation of Ionians and your families and friends. It's particularly good to be doing so face-to-face with all of us sharing this occasion of recognition, reward, and celebration as a school community. You'll understand and forgive, I hope, also some feelings of nostalgia, but be reassured that having sat where you are sitting, I fully understand the impatience of those keen to receive their hard-won prizes, and parents for whom my speech is but one element standing between them and the chance finally to relax at the end of a long day. Brevity is, as the proverb reassures us, the soul of it. The long winding road up Harrow Hill to John Lyon was for me, as for so many other former pupils of this school, the gateway to that longer journey through a challenging, rewarding career, which in my case, as you've heard from the head, has been in universities and higher education. Indeed, my student career was itself an extensive one. A gap year before my undergraduate studies, 3 years study for my BA, a further year of study on an exchange scholarship in the US, a year then to work to pay for more study, and then some postgraduate. In fact, my father, when asked by interested or concerned friends and relatives what I would be when I finished my studies, tended to reply, an old man. I then worked in 2 more universities before embarking on that long march you've heard the head describe through the organisations that shaped the university world. UCAS, QAA, and then the Tertiary Education Quality and Standards Agency in Australia. Australia, when it beckoned, meant that I had to travel, of course, to the other side of the world to regulate that great country's universities. As those of you who've made that journey down under know, it is indeed a long one. 24-hour flight. Maybe it was travel fatigue, but my arrival in Oz got off to a slightly shaky start. There's always a slight apprehension in the Greek mind as one enters what was formerly a penal colony. Some residual folk memory, perhaps. The border official beckoned me forward at the airport and scrutinised my passport. I won't attempt the accent because I still have many Australian friends that I want to keep. From the UK, he shrewdly observed, I am. Bringing any illegal goods, food, or drink into the country? No, sir. Fixing me with a suspicious stare, he asked, do you have a criminal record? didn't realise it was still a requirement. Despite this, he let me in. Getting out 5 years later, however, looked more doubtful. It was early 2020. The world was becoming aware of a new viral infection named COVID-19. The atmosphere in Australia was increasingly edgy as lockdown measures loomed. When Qantas announced that they were considering suspending all international flights, my wife and I realised that it was time to come home. The last chopper out of Saigon moment was almost upon us, and we urgently brought all our flights and got one of the last flights out to arrive back in England the day before Boris Johnson announced our first lockdown. I've come back to take up the post of Vice Chancellor at St Mary's University in 2 weeks. In contemplating the demands of my new role, I hadn't anticipated that because of lockdown and the government's no doubt wise decision to send all students home, I would spend my first few weeks in the new job seeing if it was possible to run a university from a laptop in the spare bedroom of a rented flat. Fortunately for me and for St Mary's, it did prove possible despite the inevitable Zoom. But more of that in a moment. What was I hoping for all those years ago as I made my way up the hill from the station on that first day of school? Well, I know what my parents were hoping for. From the moment they visited John Lyon to see if it would be the best place for me to go at age 11, they had no doubt at all that entrance exams permitted, it was the right school. Academically serious and excellent, of course. They were ambitious on my behalf. But so much more with outstanding music, which we've just heard about, another wonderful example. With outstanding music, a strong drama tradition, and above all, a genuine interest in providing us with a full, rounded education. Building on each student's talents, differences, and even quirks. Of course, every school says that they do that, but John Lyon, it was clear, really did and does. And football mad as I was, I like the fact that the JLS I would be able to continue playing with them together. Whether football felt quite the same way about me is another matter. But the examination board smiled on me and I started at my first choice school. You'll be relieved to know that I don't intend to go year by year through my school career. Suffice it to say, guided by some outstanding teachers and with the benign presence in Byron Hill Road of retired headmaster Mr. LeBeau, still offering tea and cake to us after cross-country runs, my emotion is drama, and I think I may claim that few who saw my Night of the Burning Pestle were left unaffected by the performance. Some indeed are still in council. The sit-on debating society, inter-house chess, and the now apparently, admission statistics tell us, deeply unfashionable subject of English literature. All of those things gave me a foundation of knowledge of how, rather than what to think, of the importance of effective communication and empathy with those with whom you live and work, that I continue to draw deeply on as my career has progressed. So yes, there is certainly a nostalgia for me today, but looking at the way that the school has developed in recent years, there is unfeigned admiration for the John Lyon School of today. I was fortunate enough to reconnect the John Lyon as a government school in 2011. One of my very first tasks was to be part of the panel that interviewed and appointed Catherine Hayes as the first female head of their all-boys HMC school. If I claim credit for that, the subsequent achievements are entirely due to the head and her team, who've taken the school onto extraordinary journeys of growth and development. Debate flourishes with the talks on the Hill, the TEDx events, the JLX talks. You only need to look at the titles to see that there is no closing of the Lyonian mind in this era of supposed cancer culture. Is the UK political system broken? In defence of conceptual art, epistemic problems with economics. Are you listening, Jesus? The school itself has broadened the course, as we've heard, joining the Great Britain to provide admin through education from 3 to 18, and most significantly, taking the bold and enormously welcome decision to admit girls to John Lyon. John Lyon, and let us not forget his wife, Jo, their dream is to adapt the song for the leaders of the Rogues, now truly one of a race of both sons and daughters. And I wish to offer, as an old Lyonian, my welcome to the Lyonian girls and their parents, friends and families who are here today. I promised a little earlier on to say something more about my university, St Mary's. It's an iron law of higher education that no Vice-Chancellor can appear on a public platform and admit to draw attention to the outstanding features of his institution. St Mary's was founded in 1850. We're beginning to think about how we're going to celebrate our 175th anniversary in 2025. We have a beautiful site in Twickenham, close to the Thames, and incorporating Strawberry Hill House, the intriguing fantasy castle built by Boris Walpole, son of Sir Robert, our first Prime Minister, and famously, the first neo-Gothic building in the country. Our strengths are education. We started life as a teacher training college. Theology, we're a Catholic foundation. Allied health, business, law, and sport. Sir Mo Farah is an alumnus, and Monty Panesar graduated last year from St Mary's with a master's degree and regularly turned out during that time for Twickenham cricket. We started this academic year by achieving our highest ever position in the Times Good University Guide, and we finished the year as the highest upward mover, 32 places, in the Times Higher Education Research Rankings. But what we're really proud of is precisely those qualities of a rounded, character-forming education that my parents identified as the key quality of John Lyon all those years ago. Our regulator, the Office for Students, measures us by how many of our students go on to achieve good jobs. And it's absolutely right that they do so, for higher education represents a significant financial investment. But the qualities that are harder to measure are precisely those that prepare you not just for the first job, but for all those jobs that will follow, for dealing with integrity, with the challenges that you will face in whichever professional field you choose to exercise your talents, for treating with respect and discernment the wonderfully diverse range of colleagues, customers, friends, supporters, and even occasionally opponents that you will encounter on the journey beyond school. At St Mary's, we try to sum these up in our values of excellence, inclusiveness, respect, and generosity of spirit. We encourage our students to embrace them all, and I likewise urge you to continue to live by the school's values, all eight of them, but particularly, perhaps, excellence, striving always to give your best to all that you attend. Is higher education right for all, or the only way to achieve your goals? No, of course not. No one would dare to assert that in the speech room graced by Sir Winston Churchill as a schoolboy. But neither is higher education the realm of oversensitive, cancelling snowflakes that some newspapers would have you believe. Although, a recent survey of the Higher Education Policy Institute that revealed that 11% of today's students would apparently ban the Conservative Party from campuses, was certainly disconcerting for anyone wedded to the principle of freedom of speech. But a university's extraordinary discoveries ahead and the rapid development of effective COVID vaccines certainly remind us of that. Robust debates are held, thoughts are tested and challenged, characters are formed and strengthened. And extraordinary resilience has been shown by students who've been taught under repeated lockdowns with what seemed like endlessly changing rules and restrictions. Snowflakes, they are not. There's much to make one cynical in the way we live now, to borrow the title of a great novel by a great Barovian. Corruption and scandal in public life, environmental degradation, institutions undermined and appears by their own failings, force and violence used to settle disputes between nations in Europe and beyond. To refresh and renew yourselves in the face of these challenges, you will find yourselves returning again and again to what you have learned and mastered here in your years at John Lyon. I have two particularly favourite people quotes. My second favourite people quote is the one famously attributed to Pope John XXIII, who, when he was asked how many people worked in the Vatican, answered about half. But my second favourite, I would say, actually, with due respect to our current Pope, my favourite quote is actually one which is on a poster outside my office in the corridor at St Mary's. And it has one of my favourite quotes from Pope Francis. Education is always an act of hope. Indeed it is. And returning to the John Lyon School today, I see that hope burning very brightly in me. Step for Tudor Dogs, and my very best wishes to all today's my audience. prizes. Collecting the Year 7 Latin Music and Physics Prize, Ali Azawi, the Year 7 Art and Mathematics Prize, along with the 7 MLD Form Prize, Amory Brown, and Zara D'Souza Gilroy collects the Year 7 Drama Prize. Year 7 History and RSP prizes go to Vanessa Dudar. Brian Ganai collects the Year 7 STEAM prize. Fatima Hamid-Lev collects the Year 7 French prize. Year 8 Digital Learning and Physics Prizes, and Yon Machidonsky collects the Year 8 fun inspiration. courage and enterprise.
Collects the year 11 computer science, music and physics prizes, and
Abhi Patel who likes the Year 11 History and RSD Prize. opposite Music Technology Prize, Ivan Philippov collects the Collingham Business Prize, and Yassir Hassan collects the opposite Art Prize. Year 7 Boys Sports Award goes to Aidan Tamlin, the
Year 7 Girls Sports Award goes to Nishka Kilnani, and Riam Johan is awarded the Junior Sportsman of the Year.
Thank you.
2019, and it is clear much has changed since then. We're now hopefully post-pandemic. Our school has nearly completed the first year of being co-educational, and we're now a school that runs from 3 all the way to 18 years up, thanks to our merge with great schools. Exams have gone ahead as normal, and the use of Teams seems like a past and distant memory. So therefore, being head boy at a time of positive change in what's now known as the new normal is something that I've enjoyed and treasured the most of. It has been a great privilege and an honour to be John Lyon's head boy this year. I have loved every minute of the responsibility, privilege and opportunities, including, as some of us I will say, the head boy's office. Whilst I'll miss the comfiness of the chair, the better view, and I have to say the bigger size compared to the other sixth form team offices, I'd like to thank the school for deciding to give the head boy and his team their own office, because it is something that constantly reminds us of the importance and the responsibility involved. Everything I've learned here will stay with me as I progress into the future. However, of course, it would have not been possible without my head boy team and all the help they've given. Therefore, I'd like to extend my thanks to Harsh, Barris, Will, and Vinay Karthik. Their consistent organisation, reliability, teamwork, support, and friendship have led to all of our successes. I'm grateful for everything that they have done. Much of the prefect team follow in the same vein, and I want to thank them too for all their hard and tireless work. Whether it be by giving up their break time to complete their duties, or stepping in at the last minute to help with the school event. I hope that all the prefects tonight know that all their support is appreciated, and that you have learned as much as I have in this valuable experience. I would also like to give thanks to the head of sixth form, Rev Mecca. His support, passion and guidance is always valued, and I'm sure that his advice will stay with me in the years to come. In that same vein, I'd also like to give a big thank you to Mr. Ling, who has worked so tirelessly in such a dedicated manner to support myself, the head boy team, and all of the prefects. And I have to say, his efficiency in responding to emails in record time is something that must be noted as well, whether it be first thing in the morning or last thing at night. I'm grateful for all of his help and support. I also thank all the academic and support staff who have not only guided us in the upper six for our A-levels, but also throughout our school careers. In particular, I would like to thank the following teachers who have had a profound impact on who I am today. To Mr. Berry, Ms. Davies, Dr. White, Ms. Dunn, and Mrs. Scotcher, I wish to personally say thank you for all your support and guidance. And I'm sure that the whole of our year will support me in saying that we're grateful for everything that the staff do. Everything that they have done, that you have done, has helped to shape us into who we are today. And I'm sure that all their advice will stay close to us and close to our hearts as we move into the next stages of our lives. Thank you. I'm sure that many of our successes this year will continue long into next year. Looking forward to next year, I'm sure that Yuki Ma, next year's head boy, will be a great success in the role. His personability and confidence will go a long way, and I wish him the best of luck. His talented team of Krish Lathani, Rafi Smith, Lucas Anthony, Sami Smith, Sahid Sahani, and Baron Valentine are all a strong selection who will do a great job. I wish them all the best in whatever lies ahead. As someone who joined the school 7 years ago, shy but enthusiastic, saying goodbye to it, it's something that will be hard, but sad and necessary. The school has had a profound impact on who I am today. I've gained confidence, friends for life, learnt the importance of taking all the opportunities available to oneself. But perhaps more importantly, I've learned the earnestness of responsibility. All the above will certainly stay with me as the future lies ahead. To all of the current pupils, I say, make the most out of the opportunities have. Be kind, work hard, and be responsible, and you will succeed. When I applied to be head boy last year, I said in my hustling speech that the value of community is something that is close to my heart. And after completing my time in the role, I'm more certain that this is something that our school should be immensely proud of. Whether it be something as simple as an older pupil giving a younger pupil directions, or the various extracurricular activities led by sixth formers, charity events. It is clear that community is something that is and will remain very important. This is something to be proud of and to keep working on. because as I have learned, it will serve you very well. Do the best for your future self and be responsible. And of course, my final thank you must go to Miss Haynes. I'm so grateful for the opportunity and the faith that she's put in me when she appointed me as head boy last year. All of her guidance and approachability always made me feel at ease. And I would like to thank her personally for all the work that she has done, she does now, and that she'll continue to do. Thank you. As I finish today, I'd like to say thank you to all the pupils and to wish them good luck in whatever lies ahead. It's been a great pleasure to serve as head boy, and I hope you all have a restful and enjoyable summer. Thank you.
We'll be right back.